morning students, welcome to the session for UDDI. So in the service oriented architecture we are traveling from XML architecture of SOA, specifically in the third unit we are talking about communication happening between web services. So today's session we are going to penetrate the next level, how services are communicating, what is the role of UDDI in this. So what made UDDI to be used, or what is the purpose of UDDI, necessity of invention, what is the purpose of this UDDI? By that we will take it into the today's session. And the second case is because web services are available when there is a accessible gap happened when web servers and application servers are introduced. People started designing web services to access the content in the application server. That made people to design web services. The reason to go for these types of servers are nothing but we started practicing the MVC architecture, Model View Controller. So this MVC architecture trifurcates the design part, main logic, database environment. So whenever we are going for maintenance, it's very easy for it to carry out the task independently without making the total application to down. So that is the reason why MVC architecture was patronized and to be followed. That's the case that how these web services are being emerged into. The ultimate aim of introducing web services is how to access the application in the application server. So what would be the role of web service here? It might be a website, or it may, from the programmatic point of view, it might be a URL. From that I could be able to access this functionality. How I am communicating with that URL, either through SOAP or RESTful service, right? So this could be the happening still now what we have seen in the environment. But how I am registering a web service, how I am publishing a web service, that means I have to convey, right? I am having this web service, kindly consume and use it. So how I am doing marketing for my environment, absolutely, right? I am having this type of work, please consume and use it. How to do that? So in that case, this UDDI has been emerged. But the role of Microsoft is very, very important here, because those people who have only introduced the SOAP, right? So the role of Microsoft is very, very important pertaining to web services also. So before they are introducing this SOAP, how they have discovered these web services, right? So from that point we will start our conversation. As we have discussed a sufficient number of classes on WSDL, I think today we no need to go through MCQ based recap, right? That's what I have given you recap till now. So now we'll get into the session directly. So before UDDI, who has done the job of UDDI? What was the limitation in that? what made UDDI to be launched in an effective way. Right? So that's the thing that we are going to move forward. This is the person who have involved in UDDI's role completely. What this will do? Discord tool. It's called actually Discord tool. Right? People who are familiar with .NET, they will know about this Discord. Whenever you are going to create the web service, by default, a Discord file will be created. Actually, okay, it's a tool. It's not a web service. Okay, it's a tool. What it would help, actually, it would help me to locate the web service. Okay, as well as what would be the role of a RESTful API that would be performed by the Discord itself. I think you could be able to see that it takes the URL and discovers and publishes discovery documents, right? Communication also it will perform. See, a single tool which perform multiple operations. It will help me to locate the web service. It will help me to communicate with the web service. It will help me to generate the request and the response messages from the web service. It would be helpful for me to identify the request and response messages also. Identify means what about the arguments that they are passing. Everything could be done through this tool itself. Right? So what are all the options available in this tool? How to use this tool? See, people who are having .NET framework in your laptop, if you access your .NET framework specifically, you have the provision to access your C# compiler through .NET, through your DOS prompt. If you have already installed .NET framework on your machine, you could be able to access the C# compiler through your DOS prompt. If you go through DOS prompt, this Discord, till now it is being available as a tool, right? You could be able to access it as an exe. Directly, you could be able to work with that. So what are all the options are available? So along with the tool, so it should be used like this, Discord/, these options can be used. Okay. So first option is domain. So it represents the major source. Domain is nothing but the major source. That's what /d, okay. It represents the major source where my service resides. It will connect to the corresponding domain. Second thing, it will not store any intermediate arguments. That's what /nosave, right? During our request and response messages, we will pass parameter values, right? Those values will not be stored. And no logo. This is specifically for, because this tool has been dedicatedly used for Microsoft products. So that is the reason why when Microsoft products are going to communicate with third party softwares, they don't want that Microsoft logo to be the flag logo, right? You might have come across the flag logo that was initially when Microsoft is being booted, the old machines. I think you may have chance to see those things. Flag logo will come. The window only will come like a flag, like Microsoft Windows. That flag logo will be void, right? This option will made it to be void. Next, so in which directory /o, in which directory the corresponding SOAP or SOAP request or response messages need to be stored, that will be specified by /o. /p, right, when I'm going to communicate with my domain, what is the password that I need to supply, I have to issue using this. Okay, so what would be the URL that I have to remove my SOAP wrapper. That means if you want to communicate like a RESTful web service, I have to use this option / that IP address name : the corresponding service name that what I need to access. Okay, so these are all the options that I could able to use. That means I say you could able to come to a virtual point, right? A single tool that will simulate the functionalities of SOAP, WSDL, UDDI. All the functionalities will be packed into a single tool, right? But what would be the drawback of this tool? What made people to work in that? When they are going to communicate with the third party vendors, they have a lot of issues, right? It started generating a lot of communication errors, right? Both of their logics, both of their programs are very good when they are running separately. When they are ready to communicate, they could not be able to integrate and work. So in that case, what are all the common points are missing, right? The property of interoperability is not exhibited. Okay, so that is the reason why what Microsoft have did, I think .NET framework started generating cab files, .cab, this cab files. So in the cab file, I could be able to mention, so these are all the, this is the source, this is the destination. These types of services are going to be communicated. Likewise, an auto-generated cab file will be helpful. So whenever heterogeneous services are going to communicate, they will contact the cab file first and they will perform communication. That will avoid the errors happening between communication between the different party, different heterogeneous web service communication. Okay, so that cab file is also, again, it's a native of a Microsoft product only. When things are open source, when things are being turned towards open source, for example, if I'm going to design a web service in Java, it is going to communicate with a web service in .NET. In that case, how it is going to work with? So the role of disco file need to be generalized. They came to a point, okay, this tool need to be generalized. That made them to trifurcate the works, right? The layers are being, the disco layers are being trifurcated. SOAP is being generalized. WSDL is being generalized. W3C started generalizing all those things and make it as a standard, okay? So these two standards are being generalized. The third one is nothing but this UDDI, right? So W3C have started recommending this UDDI to be like, yeah, I think people who are familiar with security, who are working with security, that you will come to know about the term Kerberos, right? Kerberos is a server that I could able to go on the register and I have to validate my identity, and based upon that, I'll be issuing it some unique ID. So if anybody want to communicate with me, they will go and validate with the Kerberos server. Okay, this is a person being validated by Kerberos so that I can communicate with him without any hesitation. So likewise, the security layer will built over on the Kerberos server like that. So likewise, here people are going to create a server called a UDDI, right? If any web services want to do anything, starting from the basic elements of web service, still they are communicating and exchanging messages between them. Everything could be tracked through this UDDI. Right. That could be the major case. Right. So what would be the role of this UDDI? So universal description, discovery, and integration. Right. In some places, this IE will be replaced with the identification also of web service. That's what UDDI. So how this UDDI will be used? So this diagram will give you very clearly, right? Consumer is the end user. Provider is the web service provider, okay? Or the person who is having that logic, okay? For example, provider will be, weather service provider, okay? So consumer is nothing but, so you are a programmer. You want to consume a weather service app and you want to display it in your native portal. So likewise, we could able to assume, right? So provider will go on to register with the server using UDDI. He will publish his service. I am having this weather service app. If anybody want to integrate with their native application, they can do it with the so-and-so credentials. Likewise, they will supply that. In turn, registry will verify, okay, the provider is an authenticated one. So he is having all eligible entries to make for launching the web service. Like this, they will validate. All these communications will happen through UDDI, right? Next, consumer will come and search for web services in the registry only. Okay, he will come and search the contents in the registry only, right? he will use or she will use UDDI to search for them, okay, for finding the web services. Once it is being identified through API, through API call or through any means of communication between that in a programmatic way, they will communicate via WSDL. I think you might remember your either SOAP based or RESTful. So using WSDL, they will communicate with the registry. Okay, so finally, the actual consumption, when it will come. So registry is being identified over there by the consumer. This web service that he is going to use. Now, provider, the direct consumption of service is going to happen through provider. So when the service is being invoked, they will communicate via SOAP as well as WSDL, right? So this can be dedicated for SOAP based communication, the request and the response messages happening between consumer and a provider, right? So this is the place where all these three components are being used: UDDI, WSDL, SOAP. Still, furthermore, this diagram will give you some more overlay. Before getting into the main picture, see at the bottom, you could able to see, you have application layer protocols, FTTP, HTTP, SMTP. Over them, we have a wrapper that is called SOAP. Okay, over them, you have a wrapper. If I am going to communicate directly with the FTTP or HTTP or SMTP, through that protocol, if I am going to communicate, ultimately it is called a RESTful web service. Okay. So over this protocol, if I am going to keep a layer, keep a wrapper and communicate, that is going to happen through my SOAP. Okay. So when I am going to implant SOAP in my communication, ultimately UDDA and the WSDL will come into picture. Okay. Because SOAP is a protocol that is purely used for communication, right? UDDI is a place where set of web services are being available. It could be like a repository. WSDL is a language that is used by SOAP for communication, right? I could able to see from the content. See the next level explanation from this diagram. This is very low level, the next level of explanation. So otherwise, the first diagram is abstract one, right? This will give you a detailed overview on this. Client is communicating with the provider, how they are communicating, right? Via their messages only, right? Via their messages in terms of SOAP. SOAP is responsible for communicating between client and service provider, web service provider, right? So how they will communicate? Request and response messages. Remember our factorial program, right? Request and response messages. If I send 5, I will get the result as 120, right? So they will communicate via that SOAP request and response messages. What's happening behind them? That's the main case, right? That factorial program will be available in the web services repository. Okay, web services repository. So what will happen actually? The client will go and search for the web services. Who is giving factorial web service? Likewise, it will go on to search. UDDA will inform, use this key. This key will helpful for you to open this web service. Likewise, he will the web service repository will give to us. Okay, so through that key only, it will access the corresponding web service. So if I am having more than one set of web services, for example, for calculating factorial, if I have my list of web services, so how to choose the best one? In that case only, my UDDA will give me three types of pages. At the right hand side top corner, you could able to see that it consists of green pages, white pages, yellow pages, right? Using that, sophisticatedly, I could able to choose my best web service to compute the factorial. Okay, I'll tell you what these pages are consists of the next diagram. Okay, so using those, I could able to find it out. The best web service could able to communicate it. After identifying the corresponding web service, I could able to validate with my web service repository through the UDDI will help me to validate that. Okay, it has been validated. In the same way, my validation will be informed to the service provider also. See, this client have invoked your web service. This is the identity for the client. If they have accessing you, if they are accessing your web service, it is authorized user only. Provide your interface. Likewise, information will be passed from the web service repository to the web service provider. Once all these things are being streamlined, okay, I think if you want to communicate, if you want to convey in the terms of networking terminology, once this connection oriented transfer was established, client can communicate with my service provider directly. That's all. Right? This could be the communication. In those things, the role of these components are playing vital entity, right? So web service repository will communicate back and forth between client and provider via UDDI only. Web service repository, please remember that, right? But actual communication is happening via through my SOAP only. Please remember that web service repository is communicating between client as well as provider via SOAP only, right? UDDI will help me to identify what's happening in the service side, client side, and the provider side, repository side, client side, and the provider side. Okay. So that could be the major discussion here. For programming purpose, for understanding level purpose only, WSDL will serve me the corresponding message information. Right. So SOAP will inform us. Right. This is the request message. This is the response message. So if I think in a repository, number of web services will be there, not only for factorial. Assume you have a very big list of services, weather services, for example, for managing a nuclear reactor, I'm having some set of services. For managing a rocket propulsion, jet propulsion laboratory in satellite management section, I'm having some set of web services. So likewise, list set, different types of business, different types of entities will be there. So that could be organized via these three types of pages, right? So that could be the case here that I want to stretch it upon. What is this three pages, right? What does this UDDI consist of? So here we have mentioned three pages, right? So what does this UDDI consist of? White pages, yellow pages, green pages. What does white pages will hold? It will hold about the company information, nothing but who is launching this web service. About their complete details will be available. For example, if you are going to consume some Oracle web services, about Oracle, you will have the information. If you are going to consume some startup based web services, about their startup, they have the information. Moreover, nowadays the white pages are being equipped with our resource broker itself. It will give the star rating of that company also. By that, you could be able to choose the best web service also, right? So next, yellow pages. What does this consist of? Under this company, what are all the web services are being launched that will be available, right? What are, for example, Oracle is supplying this set of web services. So that could be identifiable over there. Next, green pages. How to do e-commerce? What does the term represents? How can you incorporate the list of services available in yellow pages with your service or with some X service, okay, with some Y service, with some Z service? How to create the interface between the available list of services with the corresponding application, right? So for programmatic communication, you have to use these green pages only. Developers will access via this green pages only, right? That will be nothing but it will have your API call, right? See, if they want to incorporate, for example, I think you know about BillDesk. BillDesk is a very famous payment gateway. So this BillDesk payment gateway will be clubbed with the IRCTC application. Okay, so how they are communicating? So green pages will supply them the API call. So through that, they will communicate with each other. Actually, BillDesk is a separate web application being available. IRCTC is a separate application available. How these people are communicating between them? Via this UDDI only, right? Very specifically, these green pages will tell them how to do communicate. They will give a call, right? It could be like a function call. That's it, right? but it requires some authenticated function call. That's all. Still in detail. Okay. What does white pages consist of? Business name, contact information, human readable description, identifiers. That means some tag words to identify their corresponding company. So that's what white pages, company informations are being listed like this. Second one is yellow pages, about the list of services, what are all the products. So they will categorize depending upon services. I think you can see this yellow pages very clearly in your AWS. They will classify based upon region, geographic index, right? So in the state of Arizona, these are all the IaaS you can consume, the PaaS you can consume, the SaaS you can consume. So likewise, they will have some set of geography based contents also, right? So in this area only these services are available. In this area only these services are available. So likewise, they have given all those things in that spec, right? So green pages. So what does it consist of? See, they have mentioned service description, nothing but our WSDL, application invocation, nothing but my API call, right? So data binding, nothing but how I am going to communicate between my web service and application, right? So all those things, business rules, protocol, all those things will be given very clearly in detail, right? So no need to worry about that. So if you want to start your business, no need to develop the software. That's the ultimate point here. Already open source softwares are ready made and available. My job is to go and access the UDDA, find out what are all the web services are necessary for my business, catalog it, and identify the corresponding green pages, call them, pay them, utilize them. That's all. My application is ready. Through that, I can move for my work. Right? So that could be the complete usage of this UDDA. It could be like your yellow pages available in the home. Right? The next level that we want to penetrate. So this penetration will be helpful for you to understand in the developer's point of view. Right? So if I want to move with the UDDA, what are all the things that you need to learn? So already we have learned WSDL elements, right? So the same way only for UDDA also, we have some basic elements. Even if you are going to create your own SOA framework, you must know how to create the UDDA for your environment. So that has been projected here. So business entity. So now we are giving the, we are renaming the commercial terms for commercial terms with the programming aspect, right? So white pages are termed as business entity. Yellow pages are being termed as business services. Green pages are going to be termed as binding templates. That's all, right? These things are helpful for us to penetrate when we are going to write the program. T model, right? That could be my basic data structure that I could be able to convey, right? So that will help me. So it will be like a generic programming. Remember, it will be like a generic programming in C++ and Java. So that will help me to create different types of service accessing mechanisms. That's the role of T model. This is an example screenshot how web services are managed in Oracle application server. Okay, so this Oracle application server is having the provision for registering the web service, publishing the same in the UDDA. See, you could be able to see in the option, in the sources dialog box, you can add your web service first. Then you can register the web service. Even if you want to edit anything, you could be able to edit. Even if you want to delete the web service, you can delete. So what is the procedure actually? First, you have to add the web service. Next, you have to register the web service. Next, you have to publish to UDDA, right? Once it was being published to UDDA, you will get the relevant constraints to access the web service, right? Using that, you could be able to access. So that has been given over in the second tab, services. Once if you publish to UDDA, what will happen? Ultimately, your file will be available in this section. That's all. So how could they access and consume my web service? They have given the URL, right? See that service location. Through that URL, I could be able to access my service and use this, right? This is an example. Screenshot how practically this SOAP, WSDL and UDDA. You could be able to understand here, SOAP is not visible, right? It is the underlying protocol. The only visible items are your WSDL file and UDDA repository. right? So services tab is nothing but your UDDA repository. So sources tab is nothing but your WSDL file. That's it, right? So this is an example screenshot that will help you to move with how to register and use if you are a developer, right? Otherwise, this will help you if you are ready to consume and use. Means you can list and identify what are all the services are available. So you can incorporate the services using the corresponding URL, right? So that's the main thing. And this is the UDA registry example, right? So through this, could you able to identify what is the service I'm invoking? Anybody by seeing that? Anybody could be able to comment what is the service I'm invoking? I think that will be easy to helpful. You can identify it. I am creating a website. I want to incorporate one feature in my website. I don't want to rewrite the feature. I want to use as it is. Simply, I will call this service and I am going to use it. So what is the service I am using? You can open your mic and convey, or otherwise you can open and mention it in the chat also. What is the service I am consuming? I think this service, this screen will give you a clear picture. So you could be able to see the keys, binding key and the interface key, right? So binding key will help me to move with the data management. Interface key will move me to work with identification of service provider and the validation of client. These two things will happen here through this interface key, right? So service key will be always unique. It will not change. The service key is unique for the service provider, right? Any answers? No answers. Very good. So this is the interface point for the Google search engine, right? Google search engine. I want to incorporate Google search in my website. That's it. I want to incorporate Google search in my website. So that will make me to, I want to bind that service with my website or with my application. So if I want to bind it with my application, I have to use this binding information, right? You don't need to worry about that. Just if you access, I think in the previous screen you could be able to see, if you access this URL from web service test, that URL will ready to supply all those things. That's it, right? So if you want to do it for your own service, this is for already existing Google search engine. So this would be generated by the Oracle, right? This search engine API will be generated by the Oracle itself, right? Google have registered in the Oracle OAS. That was validated by owning service. That was my service key, okay? For your application to communicate with that, they have given the binding key. Data management will happen via my interface. That's it. How we are programming way, how we are mapping my WSDL with the UDDA, right? Already we have come across WSDL. What are all the tags are available? What are all the elements are available? We have discussed it. In the left side, you could be able to see service implementation, service binding, service interface. What are all the tags that are there? How they are mapped with the UDDA? In the right side, you could be able to see the UDDA. So here we have the main elements as business entity, business service, binding template, T model. This is what we have seen in the slides, right? So how they are being mapped with the corresponding schemas. Okay, so we'll move in depth. So how WSDL is mapped with UDDA, you must know that, right? Because in some places communication will happen via my or in some places WSDL and UDDA need to work, right? But nothing but the place that where you will communicate between my service consumer and the service producer. If I want to incorporate a UDA or if I want to generate a UDDA for a web service, these are all the contents are necessary. Business entity, business service, binding template, T model, publisher assertion, right? So these are all the things that are necessary for me to create a UDDI, right? So please remember that these five data structures are very, very important. Like your WSDL elements, these are all UDDI elements. Likewise, you can consider business entity, business service, binding template, T model, publisher assertion. So these are all the major data structures to be involved. What are all those things? These things. Already we have seen these things in the commercial way. What are all things? Yellow pages, green pages. That is what given in the programming terms, right? My white pages will talk about business entity. My yellow pages will talk about business service. My green pages will talk about binding template, T model, and the publisher assertion. That's all. This is what in the programming aspect. This is a program, we'll talk about business entity. First topic. Right? This is a program, we'll talk about business entity. So forget about the half of the portion. If you're able to remember here, first section. So the total content is about business entity, but here, what about the company? You could be able to see that it's basically the web service is from the company Acme, right? They are using the service name as IBM. What does this web service will be helpful? It is used to create web services again, right? So what could be the developer's contact? I could be able to find it over there, right? So what could be the reference key to use that? Or what are all the variables that are necessary to identify the corresponding web service? It has been mentioned in identifier bag and the category bag. So they have mentioned that. I think no need to concentrate more on this business services. Our idea here to talk about more on business entity only. It will talk about the company's description. That's what given over there. Business entity over. Second one, business service. See that? Business service. So they will issue the service key and a business key to access the corresponding web service. What is the web service? Hello World web service. So for this web service, they are giving service key. That means this key will be unique. If I want to consume that key, if you want to consume that web service, I have to use this key. That's all. Okay. What is the purpose of this business key? So it will ready to take me towards the application. Web application and web service are interacting with each other via business key. That's all. Okay. Third one, binding template. This is my binding template. So this binding template will help me simply if you want to convey. Client location is being mapped with my business application. That's it. Right? So how to identify the client location? Through a URL. That has been given through overview URL. You could be able to see that. So in that URL, Hello World web service is going to be consumed. That's all. So how they are communicating via Hello World WSDL? Nothing but a SOAP request or response message. So this could be the binding template. So binding template will consist of the previous one. What does it work with? Business service. Business service will give me the key, right? Overview URL tag will ready to supply my corresponding entity. That's all. Okay. So you could be able to see here, T model key, right? So these are based upon the instances being generated. I think n number of users will access the Hello World service. Every one of them have to be the access validation over under. So binding template we have seen. T model, right? T model. So very specifically. So they have mentioned, right? T model key is equal to UUID colon XYZ 987. They have given some dot, dot, dot. Depending upon the unique user, the key will vary here. That's it. When n number of users are going to access the same application via our web service, that they will identify using that. Publisher assertion, the last one. Right? Publisher assertion. Assertion is nothing but that is the fundamental one, or what would be the validity of the corresponding service that will be identified from this assertion XML file. Right? This assertion will help me. This is the validity of the file. This is the validity of the corresponding service that will be identified using through this assertion, right? This assertion file will be the one that will validate your web service. For example, if I'm going to store my web service in a common application server, means my web service, I will pay for it, right? If my payment, if I'm going to pay for a monthly plan or a yearly plan, means once my plan period is expired, I have to renew it. If I'm not going to renew, they will remove this assertion file. That's the importance of this assertion file, publisher assertion. So that could be the major discussion. So what are all the built-in contents? For example, if I am moving for publisher interface, so I'm having these many number of tags are there. So as a programmer, I could able to using these tags, I could able to create the or validate the web services using these interface tags. Likewise, inquiry interface as a from the client side. So if you want to inquire about the corresponding web service, programmatically, I'm having this many number of tags are there to access and use it. Okay. So these are all some of the basic implementations of UDDA available in the native languages. How Microsoft have developed its own UDDA, Disco. Likewise, for Java, we have separate UDDA. For Perl, we have separate UDDA called Lite. For Ruby, I'm having UDDA 4R. For Python also, we are having UDDA I4.5. So likewise, UDDAs are being generated for their native applications also, right? So that is also being applicable and even practiced nowadays for intranet services, okay? So if a UDDA specification, if I want to write a UDDA specification, I need all those things. Replication, operators, programmers, API, data structures. These are all the contents are necessary for my UDDA specification. So UDDA error codes are there. These are all the UDDA error codes, you would be able to see, right? It will not throw error. It will generate the error code, right? Because HTTP will generate as 404 error not found. Likewise, this protocol, this SOAP will generate my error codes. By these error codes, I need to understand that, okay, this is the issue is there. By seeing that error, I have to rectify that, right? You have set of error codes are there for UDDA communication, right? Thank you. We will meet in the next session.